2008年美国金融危机后，一家名为国宝银行的华人银行成为唯一一家被起诉的银行。面对182项指控罪名，国宝银行董事长孙启成先生及其女儿们奋起抗争。
大家好，欢迎来到旅美华人访谈录，我是东红。旅美人生，岁月永恒。那今天我们访谈的故事呢，是一个在美国的华人家庭对抗美国国家机器的抗争的故事。这个故事在美国的侨界引起了强烈的震撼。那今天我们就采访到故事的主人公，国宝银行董事长孙启成先生和他的女儿们。孙董事长您好。
您好，这样好。
对，您现在今年已是83高寿了，但您看着非常的健硕哈。其实我们都知道您是上个世纪50年代就来到了美国求学创业，然后开创了国宝银行，服务于华人社区，那么做了很多卓越的贡献。但是您在晚年的时候却遭遇了一个大家认为非常不公的这样的一个上诉啊，就是说在2008年之后美国金融危机，您是成为唯一一家被告的银行。当时您在整个的美国的银行是排名2000多位的这样的一个排行，所以呢，当您当时听到这样的一个消息之后，您当时的心情是怎样的？
当然，你得到这个知道他的动机之后呢，当然是一个非常不愉快的事情。但是呢，在我这个年龄呢，我也相当明白。这个美国这个政治的这个政客的这个心里边的期望，他的想法，所以呢也并不是觉得太惊奇，我觉得也是心里边感觉他会有这种情形发生。
是吗？你既然有感觉，那您可能在这个当中您就有预感了。
那我们那个案子，他开始时候是大概是2009年，2010年的时候发生了。发生了之后呢，有一段时间我们要供应他很多这个资料，差不多有100万张这个文件，他要传达他的文要这个文件，在传达这个文件当中呢，我们。觉得是有这个，他有这个动机，说是要损害我们这个银行的立场，所以呢，等到他公布说要正式起诉这个银行的时候呢，我们心里边已经老早就知道了，所以呢，当然我们用尽力量，希望他不要这样做法。因为一个银行是个信用机构，一开始被这个监察官方面来起诉了，一般来讲银行都是倒闭的，而且呢，他这个手段呢，里边有很多法律的手段，经过的时候。都是对这个银行是一个大的威胁，当然心里边是答复你的话的话，当然心里边是很不安心的。
当时就是曼哈顿这个检察院是吧？给您提了有各种各样的这个起诉，然后有182项的这样的一个刑事的诉讼，这个当时。您觉得要怎样才能够去反驳，去走出这种困境呢？
他一般来讲，这个检察官呢，他就是要提的这个案，提的你这个犯法的案件越多越好，对他的方面，他越容易能够得胜。所以呢，每一项提出来的这个不同的法律的观念，我们都要研究怎么样来反驳，怎么样证明他是不对，我们是没有触犯这个法律的这个要求的。所以呢，这一方面，是一个相当严格给这个紧张的一个处理的这个时候。
整个的上述其实你们耗费了大概有5年的时间，花费了有1000万的美金作为这个诉讼费。那其实我们知道最开始的时候，很多人也许别的人他们会选择就是妥协了，认罪了，那么也大概就交个600万美元的罚款但也就行了。很多的这种国际的大银行他也不敢跟政府机构进行正面的一个对抗。那您当时怎么有这么大的勇气来决定要上诉要抗争？
对，他因为我刚刚讲了银行是一个信用机构，他总是希望避免有跟这个政府这个有刑事范围当中有有这个阻碍了。那么像这种情形之下呢，一般的大的银行呢，他都是给他是讲和，给他罚款，或者是要求他不要提出诉讼，有的呢让他大家和平解决，说是我是承认有这个方面的这个不是承认罪啊，就是承认他这个有这个权来调查，因此呢可以承认呢给他罚多少多少款额，这个一般都是大银行的作风。那么像我们那个银行呢，你知道是一个小银行呢，比这个大的银行比较起来是不能算是一个算数的银行。他呢他就是用这个金融危机这个理由啦，他要说我们那个银行是因为造成金融危机的这个情况，把这个片子里边纪录片子你们看见，把这个我们的以前的员工啊，尤其是女的员工，把这个手链手铐拖在一起，这种行为呢是非常对我们种族方面是一种侮辱了，对不对？
我们大家看的那个片子确实这个他们说对待这个被告人的这种方式，对，就是感觉到是一种侮辱，对一个种族的一个不尊重。
对，他完全他的原因呢就是要表现他对这个案子，对于我们这个案子多少严重，造成这个金融危机的这个原因，也不是说是完全是我们造成，不过是我们是表示我们是造成原因的一个很重要的性质。
是啊，但是您当时都是排名美国2000多家银行，您都排名到2000多家以外的小银行，所以
呢，像他这种情形呢，我觉得是从事实方面讲也是不合理，在法律方面讲也是不合理，在这个社会道理方面讲也是不合理。他为什么他要来起诉这个华侨去的一个小的银行来做一个例子，而且他的动机是要这个银行来倒闭。那么像这种情形呢，现在变成我们的抵抗不是专门是为银行，也不是为我们个人的名望，而是为一个社区一个奋斗。所以呢，像这种情形之下呢，我们觉得是一定是要坚持要抵抗到底，要决定要希望我们能够胜利的，所以我们也有这个信心。
对，信心肯定是，但是其实有律师在最后分析的时候说，这个其实您的胜利是非常的，这个结果都是很罕见的。如果不是说有那么大的这个精力，那么大的财力去做这个胜诉，很多的案子是很渺茫的。那您当时觉得是不是因为有你女儿的这个支持和帮助呢，让你更加的觉得有信心去面对这么巨大的一个挑战？
这个案件呢是当然影响银行本身，银行本身呢 也是由我两个女儿在，包括我们两个女儿，大女儿 Vera 这个二女儿 Jill 啊，申一文申一芬，他们在里边是干事的人。那么假设说这个银行不对呢，当然是影响到他们。他这个监察官的这个动机了，他是非但要银行要倒，而且是希望这银行里边的主管人，当然最重要的人是我，对不对？但是呢，我又不是当事干事的人，因为我是年纪大了嘛，我是在做董事会里面做董事长嘛，对不对？经营的行长是我的二女儿啊，但是呢，这个。发生这个案子是的原因呢，是我大女儿发现的。这个银行的员工给这个借款人有交代这个假的文件，是我大女儿发现，二女儿处理把这个员工开除的报告跟这个银行管理局的，所以呢，他没有这个证据来告我。或者是告我的二女儿和大女儿，所以呢，结果他就是只能告这个银行本身。不过这个恐吓这个我们呢是肯定的。但是呢，因为我们在法律界也是。也我做过20年的律师，没有开银行之前，从1964年到1984年，我是做唐人街、华人街做律师的，那么我也知道这种法律上面的手术了，他的动静，所以呢，我们大家团结一起呢，要抵抗奋斗，这个案子。
这是一个其实大家说不仅仅是金融的一个事件，而且是整个华裔社区华人家庭的一个令人震撼和鼓舞的事情，因为您的最终是胜利的。但是我们在影片中也看到了您的整个家庭确实是非常团结，一起共同来面对这样的一个可以说是一个灾难。我们也知道您是非常重视家庭的教育，对女儿的培养尽心尽力，您太太也是非常可爱的一个那您其实三位女儿都毕业于美国的法律的名校，二女儿也是这个沃顿商学院 MBA 毕业的，那您在教育培养他们的过程当中我们觉得其实他们虽然不是很会太说中文，但是他们怎么样，您怎么让他来感受到这种华裔这个独特的身份呢，就是尤其在美国的这种华裔第二代。
这个功劳呢，我可以推荐给你们是我的太太的功劳，因为我呢时间多半是在外面创业了，为很多时间也是为社区服务了，那么家里边管理这个我们的。这个小孩现在也不是小孩，他们都是大人了。这一方面的教育呢，当然是受到我太太的影响，比我还多。不过呢，开玩笑了，大家要服从一个领导了。现在在家里边呢，我要听太太的话呢，小孩就听太太的话了，对不对？不需要。
是，那您太太肯定是主要在家里进行这个孩子的家庭的教育，那他怎么样，就是说你们怎么样通过一些怎么样的教育方式来让孩子认识到这种就是华裔的 Asian American 这种独特的身份。
对，在我本人方面呢，我的父母亲呢总是对中国的文化和中国的古书了，他都是非常敬佩的，让我们学习。我当然来到美国很早，小的时候就来了，但是呢这个影响总是在这里， 我们在家里边虽然没有这个机会教这个我们的小孩这个中文，但是呢他们也知道这个是重要，这个我们是华人嘛，在国外应该有一个特别的一个不同的一个立场，一个观念方面要怎么样，自己要保护自己的这个文化，可不要受到这个不好的影响。像这种情形之下呢，当然我说一般小孩的教育呢，也是自己父母也这个榜样也是一个要紧的方面的观念。
那他们在有个时候会比如会遇到一个身份的迷失，会觉得茫然的时候，比如说会对自己的身份或者有没有不太认同的时候，您会怎么样来告诉和帮助他们？
这个事情呢，我们的小孩虽然他没有，因为这小孩多嘛，大家忙嘛，所以没有花这个时间来给他们教育他们这个又要英文，对不对？又要再读这个中文书，而且住的给离开这个华人这个区又远一点。所以呢在这一方面是有一点缺点，但是他们在大学里边也每个人也是去读中文，多多少少呢能够得到一点中国的文化的影响。
Hi there. So you are the director of the bar. You handle the non-clothing department.
As well, yes.
Yeah. So how do you feel when you heard the news that Manhattan government agency is going to charge you for something? So what do you feel at that moment?
You actually, it's one of those defining moments that you always remember in your life. There's always a few of those moments. And when that actually happened, I realized how precious liberty and justice are, the two things. And that up until that moment, probably I had always taken it for granted that we all enjoy liberty and justice, but I suddenly realized those two things can be taken away like that, very easily. And to me, that's very wrong. And I really realized at that moment in time how we really need to make changes in our criminal justice system. But for us, going through this, it was so upsetting. I was very angry because I felt it was wrong. And I also knew that we had so much to do now. But at the same time, because we understood the justice system, we also knew that we have a right to go to trial. So at the same time, we also felt a sense of, wow, relief almost. Now we know that this has happened. There's only one direction that we have to go, and that is to go to trial and be able to tell the truth. We have a right to be able to tell our side.
You're Nora, right?
Right.
So do you really trust American justice?
Ultimately, yes, I have to. I think that I trust the justice system, except I think there's a lot of things within the justice system that need to be revised, reformed, and changed. Okay? And if they are not done, then we have a serious problem, because a lot of innocent people can be found guilty, and that's wrong. There's a saying that you'd rather have 100 guilty people go free than have one innocent person convicted.
Yeah, so do you feel it's like a discrimination just because you're an Asian American?
Yeah. I do feel very strongly that there's discrimination in this case, and there were so many instances. So if you remember in the movie, the way they had everybody walking in the chains,
yes.
There were all these women and who have never had any issue before in the past with the law, who are immigrants who can't even speak English, is not even their first language, and they're all led together down in the chain with the handcuffs around their wrists. It's just, it's so upsetting. It makes you feel so angry because where do you actually see this ever? You don't see this, right? Only in cases where there's involving organized crime or there it's involving a crime with violence and danger, that's when you see that. But in this particular case, there were three people who already had been arraigned, already had bail set, already had their passports confiscated. They came back to be rearranged with all these other individuals, and they, again, they were put together in the chain with them, which is wrong, it's unheard of. There's also other instances that prove that there was discrimination. They actually threatened we heard that they threatened their immigration status and said, oh, you know, you better tell us what we want to hear, otherwise you may never be able to see your family here again. Yes.
So how the director of their documentary began to start to film the everything?
Yes. So the reason why how the documentary came to be made is because mm-hmm. I was friends with the producer, Mark Mitten, for at least 10 years. And through those years, he got to know my family as well. 10 years ago, he was not a movie producer. He was doing something else at that time. But then, as a friend, I was sharing with him what was going on in our case. And then when the trial started, he said, oh, I really think a documentary needs to be made because there's so little in the news about this case. And you are the only bank that has been indicted in the wake of the 2008 financial crisis. Mm-hmm. Why isn't anybody else reporting about this? Mm-hmm. A documentary should be made. And he had, at that time, worked with the director, Steve James, on one other film called Life Itself. So he brought Steve James to meet all of us. And we met him. My parents met him. I don't think my parents even knew who Steve James was, but he's a very well-known documentary director here in the United States. And they just talked to him, he got to talk to them, and I think they've developed, you know, some sort of relationship, and they trusted him. So, and eventually our whole family agreed to have the documentary made. But initially, we all didn't want to do it. We didn't, it's a very stressful time. To have camera in front of you. None of us have the experience of having camera in front of us while we are doing our regular, you know, things, especially during a stressful time period like this. So, but we eventually decided that this was so important to do.
Hajiu, so you are the president and CEO of Abacus. And we know Abacus' goal is to ensure every member of this community to achieve its success. So after the 100% achievement of the litigation, what kind of service do you currently provide to all the Asian American community?
So we provide services that we believe our community needs, and we hope to make sure our services grow with our community. So initially when my father started the bank, he focused on the first generation of immigrants who came here, and they had basic needs such as opening a savings account, and then later on a checking account, and then later on a CD, and then after they save their money they buy a house, and then after that, sometimes after they made some money they also send the money back to China wire transfer. Now we've seen over the years that the community has changed a little bit. It's not just the first generation, it's the second generation. And also we also are noticing that a lot of the new immigrants coming in are Chinese nationals who don't necessarily live here, but they might want to invest here, or they might want to establish a home here so that their children can live here while they go to school here. So we have to adjust our services to try to serve those customers as well. So for example, we launched last year a mortgage product so that the parents who live in China, if they want to buy a house for their children who are going to school here, they can buy the house using us as financing.
Oh, okay, good.
Yes, and one of the things we thought would be good is also if they put their child as a borrower, assuming the child is of legal age to be a borrower, then the child actually can get a credit history established here in the United States because they are also named as a borrower on the loan. And we understood that one of the things the younger generation needs coming here as students is to establish a credit history here, so that once they establish it, they themselves can go out and get loans and establish their life, financial life here as well. So that's one of the things we created a year ago. We launched it, and we've been lending to foreign nationals on that product. We also find that a lot of the people from China who are not necessarily living here but are investing here want to buy other types of property, investment properties, not just for their children to live in. And we're starting to open up that product to help them buy investment properties as well. And we offer deposit service for them as well, because a lot of them have money here in the United States, and so they buy the house, and then they have some money they want to use to pay for the mortgage. They need an account to hold that money, and we will let them open the account here. We actually allow them to open the account here when they're in China. Even if, let's say, they can't come here to open the account, we allow them to sign the documents in China to open the account here, and they can just go to the U.S. Embassy in China to have their signatures notarized there, and they just mail those documents here, and we open the account for them, and they wire the money here. So we try to accommodate this kind of what we see new immigrants who are helping the community. They're not really immigrants, they're not living here, but they are investing in this community. And they're of this community, and their relationships are in this community, so we want to help them. So the second generation are people who tend to be younger, and so what we're trying to do is opening up our services to allow them more. We increased our internet, online, electronic banking services. So we have a full service of internet banking and mobile banking. And this, we established our internet banking and mobile banking for individuals, personal account holders, 3 years ago. And last year, we relaunched our business banking, internet banking, which also included mobile banking. And that allows customers, for example, to deposit checks, even business customers deposit checks by taking the picture and then submitting the check that way through the picture, not having to come to the bank to using the camera. Take the picture, mobile deposit, we call it. So these are some of the ways we are adjusting our services, our more traditional services, to address how we see the communities changing. We still offer our same services to the original customers, because we can't forget them, right? They're still here, and they're very important part of the community. So we even still offer passbook savings accounts. Passbook savings account is not many big banks offer them anymore. They're basically, it's a book that you put your savings account information in there. There's no statement. And we still offer that to a lot of the older generation here, because they really still believe that's the same, you know, they feel comfortable with that. So we try to straddle both all types of people, all different ages, and all different backgrounds they have in this community.
So, yeah, it's really very huge help to the new immigrants here.
Right.
So we are just talking about, do you want to film a new documentary after you get the success of the litigation?
For me, I don't need another film. I'm so busy. You know, I think most important for me is that the bank continues to be, the word is relevant. Relevant means important to this community, and important to help this community. And so my main focus in my job is to make sure we do that. So there's so much changes in the banking world and the financial world. There's so much changing in the world in general. And so that my attention 100%, I believe, should be focused on making sure that this bank adapts to these changes. The documentary film is for other people to worry about. So I think my interest is more focused on the business and the bank's mission to make sure we serve who we're supposed to serve.
Thank you.
那今天呢，我们很荣幸地采访到了国宝银行董事长孙启成先生及他的女儿，他们的故事已经被拍成了一个纪录片，这是一部反映了美国华人家庭和美国国家机构进行抗争的影片。它反映的不仅仅是金融的故事，它也反映了整个华人亚裔社区在美国的生活和现状，以及一种羸弱的政治力量。我们衷心地为这个故事的主人公孙启成先生以及他的家人经过五年不懈的努力抗战争取而终于胜利感到欢欣鼓舞。